Everybody's very serious because there's a camera. So you all have to behave. Ask only questions which are pertinent. Yeah, respect, all of that. Yeah. Everybody knows me. Thank you. We are talking about things which are a continuation of some of which we've already talked about. Let's get to go. Right, so we've talked about, over the last month, creating new privileges or rights in international law, which gives certain non-horizontal or state actors an entitlement with remedies in international law, which allows them to access certain institutions. We talked about that, whether that's neutral, whether in the context of bilateral investment treaties, human rights, in international criminal law, domestic criminal law, etc. In the context now of WTO, which is World Trade Organization, which everybody knows, of course, which is instituted through the General Agreement on Tariff and Trade, which is a multilateral agreement, which of course not every country was a member when it was signed, is a comprehensive agreement for promotion of global trade. Right? Everybody signed on to it. In terms of a concession of sovereignty, a fairly neutral, and I use the word in the context that I've used consistently with irony and for whatever it means, a fairly neutral way to promote the basic principles which was founded on, which is reduction of tariffs and non-discrimination. Non-discrimination in the sense that you will not discriminate against goods, services originating in another country vis-a-vis nationals. You must give every country, most favored nation is a member of the global agreement, you must give all of those countries who have most favored nation status the ability to have the products and services treated like national products. As part of this World Trade Organization, you have what has been set up is a dispute settlement mechanism, which is very much like arbitration, an alternative mechanism where a panel is set up from the member countries of the WTO to arbitrate disputes setting up which are arising from interpretations of the treaty. Now again, this is what's set up with an idea that this is in fact a fairly neutral way for countries which are on the periphery or who are weaker in trade to have the GATT agreements implemented vis-a-vis bigger countries, more powerful countries in a real political sense. The interpretation, of course, as you all know, if you've looked at other interpretations, have been quite different. So, we've seen consistently what happened in the 60s and 70s and 80s in international law was a sense that sovereignty meant in international law that countries had the power to regulate economic policy, their natural resources. We've gone through a series of resolutions, including the New Economic Order Resolution, which actually talked about how these countries, and this is in the context of decolonization, these countries in fact were to be given not only political power, not just territorial power, not only the power of monopoly of violence, but economic power over the resources. And this is very much in this context that in a decolonization process, without sovereignty being equated with economic power, the ability to regulate your resources, it was a bit of a chimera. You couldn't really exercise your sovereignty. And we had wars about this, the Suez crisis, the Iran nationalization over oil, over other resources. But this was where we were arriving at in the 70s and 80s. We talked about how the bilateral investment treaties, people who are investing in other countries were then given a separate right outside of these new developments in international law, which gave private players a vertical right in international law to protect investment. An extremely substantial right, which was represented as, in a sleight of hand, as a very efficient, not technocratic protection of contracts that already existed. Similarly, in the World Trade Organization, which is implementing the GATT, you had, again, the argument that global trade was good for what? Sustainable development. Right? Yeah, why was global trade good? Not because it's inherently good, there's no natural justice that trade must occur. Trade has always been regulated. Right? But it was good because it was good for sustainable development. And of course, the idea of what is sustainable development is always a good question, whether sustainable development is to sustain the environment in which development is happening, environment, of course, I mean by the natural environment, or is it to just actually sustain development? But that's in the preamble. You must have trade as an efficient means to promote sustainable development. And by trade, it is a way to, in fact, open up tariffs, reduce protectionism, not have any domestic policy for industrialization, but you must be open to trade. Now, just starting from that, very much the preamble of the very essential ideology of global trade, whatever you think of global trade is a deeply flawed efficiency argument. Because in fact, if you look at empirically a lot of East Asia, there was no free trade. South Korea did not develop from a fairly low, least developed country to a highly advanced developed country from free trade. It did it from an extreme program, sort of ideological stance of self-sufficiency, export, they were granted access to markets, and industrialization, which of course would not have been possible if in fact GATT had existed. Similarly with Taiwan, similarly with a lot of the Asian tigers, many countries that have actually developed have developed from an extremely counterpoint to what are the principles enshrined in GATT. So just from an efficiency argument, we've talked about efficiency being, of course, the new role, at least ideologically, of what law must serve. So even from an efficiency argument, it's a deeply flawed argument. Without going into the economics of it, you know, just looking at the empirical evidence, is free trade, most favored nations, a reduction of tariffs, etc., actually good for development? And by development, we are taking it in a very narrow sense, initially, we will expand that. Development in terms of simple numbers, GDP growth, nothing more. And by the way, you're allowed to interrupt, this is no different, there's no reason to stay quiet. Questions arrive, you don't have to take them in the end, right? So this is where the World Trade Organization or the GATT agreement starts from. And of course, the dispute settlement is what we will focus on, talks about. And this is, we've seen this also increasingly in bilateral investment treaties. Because what you do is you make an efficient argument, efficiency argument, saying this is something which is good for development, so who can be against it? It's like being against children, who doesn't like children? I am against development. Is anybody against development? Does anybody want to stay back? No. Right? Who can be against development? Development is good for everyone. So it presents itself as something which is very, very a win-win situation. When in reality, of course, no such situation exists. Because in distribution, there's always a political choice which you have to make. And that was what the international law was developing towards in the 70s and 80s, was giving who the ability to make those economic choices? Sovereign states. Whatever bad rap they've gotten, sovereign states were getting the ability to make those choices in international law without review or without interference from other states. Of course, even in law, even the US courts that was developing, but we've seen with Chevron, where they actually sit in review of domestic policy, we've seen in bilateral investment treaties, where the regulation, whether it's Tanzania or Argentina or another country, is being reviewed by arbitration panels, increasingly, choices which were economic policy choices, choices of distribution within countries, were being subjected to transnational or international review in spite of international law saying, because it was in the guise of normative efficiency arguments. Similarly, the door opened the trade. Now you no longer must make policies which are according to your normative, but you must make policies which are consistent with your international obligations to other countries, which are your horizontal obligations, which are subject to the dispute settlement mechanism of the WTO, which are good for sustainable development. How good? Through allowing access to your markets and goods and services in a non-discriminatory, most favored nation manner. And this is where it all starts. Now, who is it privileged? I mean, you're giving one country to another country rights. Who does the right, as we talked about, who does it create a right for? Of course, nobody can go as a private company to the World Trade Organization. Unlike bilateral investment treaty, it is not an explicit right that is given to a private company or an exporter of goods or services. It is a right given to countries. But as we discussed, there is still an implicit right given to the person who is in fact trading. That implicit right is that they can ask their government, and in fact, like in the US, there's a very formal legal mechanism by which you can invoke the US government acting as a pares et tri on your behalf to approach the WTO for assertion of this right. So it privatizes international again. It gives private exporters an ability to go, of course, not just US exporters, but any country exporters. Anybody who's exporting, the ability to approach through their countries a World Trade Organization, which is not just arbitrating a dispute based on domestic law, but is in fact arbitrating the country's commitments based on what? On a normative efficiency argument that free trade is in fact essential for development. We are obligated to go towards free trade, and so any regulation which impedes free trade, even if it is subject to the narrow exceptions given in the World Trade Organization, public order, morals, etc., etc., must be justified. It must have a justification which allows it to overcome is impeding of free trade. Now this is a very powerful or high threshold. And this is what's given to, for example, in the US, fairly global analogy, in the US, to impediments to free speech. And as you were probably studying other classes, in the US, free speech is absolute. Right? A really strict life standard saying you must not only show that this in fact is towards public morals or public order or some sanitary and physiosanitary measure, but in fact it is scientifically proven. It is, you cannot do it in any other way which doesn't impede trade, because trade is the essential efficiency argument, the essential goal of the World Trade Organization. So the substantial right created an efficiency argument, if you go back to a parallel between efficiency and equity considerations, is what? Is that the efficiency arguments must triumph in the dispute, because that is what the dispute is settling. It's not looking at any regulation of a country, whether it's for restricting apples, we talked about South Korea. So, for example, we have a case, and this is one of my personal favorites, because it concerns, you know, something which is very ubiquitous in a way, but everybody thinks about it. So in South Korea, you have something that every South Korean is doing. It is drunk in copious quantities, unfortunately or fortunately, depending on your perspective. Soju. Talked about it last year also. Soju is a rice-based alcohol. The taxes for soju vis-a-vis whiskey, gin, whatever was imported or produced domestically, were at various. So the soju was very, in fact, a very much, I am very wary of using the word cultural, but very much part of the milieu, if you want to call it, things can change. But something which was part of locally produced, locally consumed, part of Korean tradition. As much as it was very much considered a working man's drink, very much like beer may have been in the US. It was very much considered part of a normal meal, or not. Whenever you went to any public eating establishment, soju was consumed. And houses when you went, you were offered soju. So the government had a different rate of taxation for soju versus other forms of alcohol. Now what goes into alcohol? What is this chemical composition? Well, invariably it has some percentage of alcohol, right? Even measure that and put it on board. 10%, 20%, 30%. But is that what all it is? Or does it have an association for us? Those who drink or don't drink, has an association based on where we come from, based on what we like, based on what you are. You may drink wine, you may drink beer, right? It has an association. So the World Trade Organization and an action brought by other countries like Japan, etc., which were in fact the exporters of the alcohol, determined that this was substituted because of alcohol content. Mainly because, and we'll hear more about it later, mainly because of the alcohol contents, different kinds of alcohol were in fact completely substitutable products. So what are they not considering in this fact? Right? If you look at what, which I'm trying to describe without using the word culture, what are those factors that have to be considered? Those factors are, of course, the ability of communities to make their own decisions. Right? We call it culture. The ability of communities to support certain means of production, which are locally produced, rice being a major constituent in Korea, to keep those traditions of production alive. As a choice, whether you agree or disagree with them, as a choice. Obviously, some level of democratic ocean and resistance out there. People had made that choice that there was a variation in taxation. There was not a large demand from consumers of South Korea demanding whiskey or gin, or whatever you want to call it, or Italian wine, for example. But it was really with regard to hard spirits. However, the WTO determined that no, what the market really needed was choice. Which, of course, is choice essential to development? You could argue. But of course, consumer choice is very essential to an idea of free trade, of competition, to an idea that you must promote this, and that's the only means to develop. It's not just enough having production, you must actually have consumer choice. If you can't get X number of things, you are in fact limiting development. So it's a particular idea of development. And in that, what I call a very normative idea, in that idea, the South Korean measure, which was very traditional, had always been there, which kept a different rate of taxation for soju versus other kinds of alcohol, was in fact an impediment. So who benefits from that measure? Development? No. The people who make what? Whiskey. Right? And what have you just created for them? You've created a right in a public law international public law institution where through their states they can approach, right, and get compensation from between the states. But what it really does is it sets up an international mechanism to review sovereign policies on economics, on distribution, on cultural mechanisms, on a democratic ocean by a body whose substantial law is based on an efficiency argument that trade is good for global development. And that's the state of health. Nobody, when they entered the WTO, were really thinking that their public policies were going to be reviewed on this level. But this is what, in effect, it does. Right? And case after case like this demonstrates. It grips private players implicitly of course, acting through their countries, a right because they're participating in global trade, to have and to challenge the policies of a country based on a particular ideological stance. Because free trade is an ideological stance. It privatizes international law. And of course, now who are the members of the WTO? But countries. Right? Not every country, but most countries. Right? Countries are the members of the WTO, right? And of course, all countries are equally represented. All countries have the same power. But even in the way the mechanism is set up, not all countries have the same power. And there's this fascinating case for gambling. Right? Now, gambling is something which some countries allow. If you go to Macau, the whole country is built on gambling. If you go to Vegas, the whole city is built on gambling. You go some other place, gambling is not allowed. I went recently across the border from Italy to Slovenia, and there's a big sign that says drive-through casino. You know, right at the borders. Obviously, Slovenians and Italians have a different relationship, or at least as a community, they've determined that gambling, they have a different relationship. Right? For some, it's a completely acceptable form of recreation, and in fact, it's covered in the GATT schedule as other recreation, other than sports, gambling services. Does anybody know where Antigua is? It's an island, lovely island, supposedly good pictures. It's an island which started a number of businesses based on online gambling. So, you know, you go poker online, etc., etc., which will be marketed to the US, which just in fact ran afoul of US laws on interstate gambling, wire laws, etc., etc. You may disagree or agree with US law, they have a historical precedent, right, about what are the effects of gambling, how they have to be regulated. You can go to Vegas, but you can't, you know, bet in Pennsylvania or buy beer on Saturday and Sunday. But, you know, every state in the US has different laws on morality, which is their community choices. Because we're accepting for now that there's a democratic quotient in these choices. It may not be perfect, it is certainly open for critique, but there's a democratic quotient in these choices. And based on international law, at least, sovereigns have the right to make those choices. And even Article 15 of GATT talks about public morality, public order being an exception. So Antigua takes the US, you know, this is really like the David and Goliath story. Antigua takes the US to the WTO and says, you are stopping, which are primarily US companies headquartered in Antigua, you are stopping our companies from selling across borders gambling services, which is a violation of GATT. Has anybody seen that movie, The Mouse That Rolled? It's like a, is it Peter Sellers? The Mouse That Rolled, right? With this small, fictional European country which can't get anybody's attention and has a deep crisis, decides to invade the US to get attention. And nobody bothers. So Antigua decides to take the US to court, the WTO, and it lasts forever, and they win every round. In fact, the WTO and the appeals panel decides, yes, there is a public order element to it, but it impeded trade and you had to give equal treatment, so you could not have done that, and you must change your laws. Does the US change the laws because Antigua has taken them to court? No. This is the US, this is Antigua. Somebody brings me. I'll pay the lawyer, but I'm not going to change my law. So there's what happens then? Because I want to use this as a way to illustrate the remedy. Because even though it was designed to let smaller countries come in, the remedy is what? Trade sanctions. So Antigua tries a lot of things. It actually goes to the WTO and says, you should allow me to sell movies and other copyrighted intellectual property that belongs to the US into the US without paying license fees for it as compensation, etc. Well, in the end, it's determined that Antigua can impose economic sanctions in the US. They do not have to comply with their requirements vis-a-vis the US on WTO. They can discriminate against US exports to Antigua. This is a remedy that is important, which is consistent with the structure, reciprocity of the WTO. Does the US really care about Antigua putting duties on its imports? Tiny little island in the Caribbean? No. So nothing changes. So even in the remedy given, because the right is only as much as the remedy given, even in the remedy given, which is based on neutrality of countries, it depends on your trading power. Even if you win in such a mechanism, right, here we have a reversal of the situation where you have a very small little country trying to assert the technicality. And by the way, you know, here you must talk about the ingenuity of lawyers. Antigua had nothing to do with it. It was a bunch of American corporations who reincorporated themselves in Antigua and a bunch of American lawyers who decided to use the technicality of the law, right, and Antigua as a base to do something they could not do in the US. Right? So it's not sort of a moral story. It wasn't that Antigua had a homegrown cultural industry of gambling, which it does, but not for exporting its services. But somebody was using the technical argument of the law to try and game the system. But the remedy available, of course, was not, in fact, implemented. This is an extreme case, but this happens in cases after cases where there is, in fact, an inequality between the countries. So, in essence, are we talking about a rule-based system or a realist system in terms of the World Trade Organization? You know, even if we take away whether the right being created as an efficiency right, sorry, a right based on an efficiency argument is in itself deeply flawed, right? And you say, okay, all laws, property rights also have flaws in it, but you can actually use the mechanism to try and take advantage for the person who's weaker. So a rule-based system will at least diminish some of the realist power-based equations where law doesn't exist. You know, so this is always the argument in favor or even of even unequal laws. Or at least an argument attempted to. But if the remedy is based on your economic power to act, where does that end? Questions so far? You're too silent for my life. This is because of the camera. Let's have some questions. Thoughts, opinions, none. It's not even early in the morning.
I'm curious about the cases you're mentioning about the WTO. Can you go deep in the explanation about real cases regarding alcohol production and...
So this was a soju case for real case?
Yeah, no. The yearly context...
I am supposed to explain then.
You're talking about that?
Yes.
Oh, the soju case?
Yes.
So we have a full explanation on that. So I will bring the details. And EC Horn and somebody else is doing it.
Yeah.
You're doing EC Horn, right?
I don't know which case.
Yeah, okay. Good. So, we go into the details of the case. But in the end, right, we come into an argument in these cases invariably, right? Because what is each country arguing about? If you look at an argument, moving back from the remedy and the real political question, coming back to what you were saying, if you look at the argument, right, there is trade, simply put, trade is good for sustainable development, hence it's efficient, and we must not impede trade. What is a country able to argue in retaliation or in response to it. What is a country's defense?
That you can develop your own national policies and protect some social values or even local industry.
Right, and this is enshrined, right? And no, you can't. You can't say I'm protecting local industry. Because you can't. The chapeau of Article 14 of the GATT, in fact, says that you cannot be intended to support local industry. That, in fact, is ruled out entirely. So even as a critical factor, you say, I've got 1,000 jobs to protect here, that's not a factor you can say. You cannot rule anything which is going to be protectionism as a factor. So it's suddenly ruled out economic policy where you're promoting certain industries or promoting certain jobs to exist in your country. That entirely goes away. You can make a car anywhere, you can make anything anywhere. Right? Labeling, a little bit of labeling is allowed. So you can, in fact, only label things based on where they're made. And this is, of course, very important for what? Wines, food, you know, this movement where is food made? In French, the AOC, in Italy, the DOC, is that correct? Right? This is where it's been allowed to some extent. Where there is a consumability or a factor associated with a geographic indicator. But beyond that, you cannot use as a response anything which protects a particular kind of economic policy which favors self-sufficiency. Where does this affect the most? And of course, food is something that is just coming into the country. Is food production. Tell me, what foods are grown besides cherries in summer in Italy? Right? Italy is a bad example. I mean, this is, of course, within Italy, you do get this food, etc. But in most countries in the world, when you go to the supermarket, you get the same fruits every year. In development, right? You get the same fruits and food every throughout the year. Why? Because there is a global trade in food. Right? It may be produced in South America, in Africa, in Asia. You will get apples in winter or summer, depending on where you are, irrespective of where they were made. You will get aubergines throughout the year. You will get potatoes throughout the year. You will get grapes throughout the year. You will get mangoes throughout the year. You know there's a mango season. And it's not even one season. In May in India, you will get one particular kind of mango. And in June, you will get another kind of mango. And if you're out of the country, you miss like two varieties of mango for 3 weeks teaching your class in the region. You know, it's gone. That experience for this year is finished. You can go and try and find it, but that mango goes. Because that's how fruits are, right? They don't come out of the earth throughout the year. They are. So why do we get, in most countries, fruit every part of the year? Trade. There is a trade, a commodification of food. Right? So we get this amazing ability to eat what we want, when we want it, for very reasonable cost. If you look at the inflation of food, limited compared to other objects. Of course, not in certain countries, but generally in Europe, right? Food as part of your consumption, in terms of food that you get home, okay? I'm not talking about the fancy restaurants, etc. But food as a part of your consumption used to be about 30% or more of a person's income. That has declined considerably. Very good for everyone, right? Who's it not good for? Which industry is the most industry, but which means of livelihood is the most in crisis in the world? Besides PhD students, professors.
The car industry?
I'm sorry?
The car industry,
that's only fear. No. Farmers. Today we have an industry of means of production which employs the maximum number of people in the world, which does not have an economic model which is sustainable. You cannot, without subsidies, without some support from the state, in fact, eke out a reasonable livelihood from a farm, without industrialization, as a farm. It is a sector deeply in crisis, and a sector subject to global trade. Right? So if you want to say, I want to protect my farmers, and certainly, of course, that's being phased on farmers, but if you want to say that, that is not in the structure, it's an exception given temporarily, but that is not allowed. Right? Of course, in Europe, we have subsidies, which allows farmers to sustain themselves. In other countries, you have different kinds of support. In many countries, you don't. Which is why there's this deep crisis, right? Because when you have a population that's 60% or 50% or 70%, these are numbers which I'm not making up. Most developing countries have these kind of numbers of people deployed in agriculture. So when you have countries where the majority or a plurality of your population is engaged in agriculture, and yet that sector is not able to provide for them, which was not true 30, 40 years ago, what do you have? You have social crisis. But not only do you have social crisis, you have something deeper. You have urbanization. You have people talking insane things like, and can you do this without social trauma and violence to some extent? Which is like, we of course cannot sustain 60% of our population in agriculture. So over the next 20 years, we will move 20% of our population into the cities and make them employees in manufacturing. And for this, we need to acquire the land which is currently used for farming from the farmers and force them to change their means of production, because in fact, what they do is no longer efficient in a global system, because a factory farm somewhere else can manufacture the same thing much more cheaply, which is the reality. Never said, but that's the reality. So you have societies where you have slums. What does overgrowth in cities produce? Slums, migration, social trauma, breakdown of families, right? People going to other countries to work, leaving their families behind. All of this arises from what? The inability to make agriculture, in fact, a sustainable means of production. Can you use that argument in the WTO as an equitable consideration for an economic policy? No. Because the narrow arguments that are allowed have to do with what? Public order, public morality, sanitary measures, what is called the SPS agreement. And even then, it cannot be under the chapeau that you actually did these measures when your aim was in fact protectionism.
May I ask a question?
Of course.
We have talked about another case in the other class we had here at IUC, about the dispute between US and one of the European Union countries, or EU itself, about beef supply. US was supplying beef, and then it was discovered that this meat contains a lot of hormones, and one of the countries... Oh,
we're not talking about this. Nobody's talking about this today. Oh, okay.
Terminated the supplying contract, and US brought a case before WTO tribunal, and they won.
Mm-hmm.
WTO decided in favor of US, and I think it's like a very controversial decision, because of course the reason for terminating the contract was health issues and protecting of the citizens' health, and in this case you can't even protect on such a high importance issues your local nationals, and because of reasons of efficiency and non nation, and is there some kind of, I don't know, arguments that could be used in order to claim against this kind of policy?
So do you remember what arguments were used in that case?
In this one? Unfortunately, I didn't go with it.
No, but that's a very good illustration, the hormone states, right? Because basically, Article 14 says you can have necessary to protect public morals or maintain public order. Or you can have necessary to protect human, animal, or plant rights. Right? Or you can have necessary to secure compliance, etc., etc. Now, the real issue here is, how narrowly do you read? How narrowly do you read necessity? Is it proven that hormones are bad in beef? Do you want to eat beef with hormones in it?
No.
Does anybody here want to eat? Has anybody traveled to the US? Somebody must have traveled to the US, right? Have you eaten meat in the US? So you eat it, right? Did you say, I'm not going to eat meat in the US because it has hormones in it? No. Right? There are lovely burgers in the US, now there are lovely burgers in Toronto, but I think they don't have hormones in them, right? So has anybody not eaten beef in the US for hormones? Whoever's traveled to the US, I presume some of you have. So you eat in a burger, right? But if I also ask you, do you want hormones in beef? My answer, and I'm the same way, so it's okay. Inconsistency in personal life is a natural state of being, right? Right, because we expect somebody else looking after and not allowing us to eat things which are bad for us. If I was to ask you, do you want hormones in your beef? What would your answer be?
No.
No, right? Why? Why don't you want hormones in your beef? Do you know it's harmful for you?
But we also don't know that it's not harmful for us.
But you don't know it's harmful. So how dare you impede trade based on uncertainty? I'm saying this, mocking it, but this is the argument of the dispute settlement board. How dare you impede trade based on uncertain scientific conclusion of whether hormones are bad for you or not in beef? Because there's no scientific conclusion that they're bad for you. And consumer anxiety is what you're expressing here, obviously inconsistently when you travel to the US, is not sufficient. Because nowhere does it say this is necessary for public order, morals, or sanitary. Where is the necessity? You have no scientific proof of this. Right? This is the argument. Is that the correct argument? Should you, as a community, not you personally, of course, always have a right, right? You can eat, well, can you eat things of genetic modification? Depends, right? If you allow genetically modified foods to come in, then, you know, you can't really limit it. Everything can become genetically modified because you can't actually restrict it. So even if one country in Europe, and I know this has been discussed, allows it, you are now subject to genetically modified foods. You cannot limit it. And this is a huge issue in the World Trade Organization and in trade agreements. Right? Genetically modified foods must come in because of what? What is the argument used for genetically modified foods? Because companies want to make money, that means the real reason. What is the argument used to allow genetically modified foods to spread across the world?
Efficiency.
Efficiency in food production. We need to feed a lot of people, so we need genetically modified food. In fact, there is no problem in food production. There is not just empirical evidence, not just academic evidence, policy evidence, that no famine in the world has been there due to shortage of food. Famines are a consequence of what? So that is a temporary measure, right? There's always food next door, in the next country. The world has an excess of food supply. What famines result from is the inability of those who depend on food for manufacture, on livelihood, who suddenly have a drought, so they don't have the food, to be able to do what? Buy food. It is a distribution problem. It is not a production problem. Famines are never a production problem. They're a problem of distribution, right? Which is why one of the best mechanisms for countering famines is public employment, public works, right? When somebody, or just giving money to farmers to buy food. Because what happens when you suddenly import free food where there's famine? What is the first sector that you destroy? The farmer whose actually crops were not destroyed. Because guess what happens? In any country where there is mass scale importation of food, the price of food, what happens to the price of food? Minimal microeconomics. What happens when you flood the market with US AID rice? price of rice collapses. So the farmer who actually may have had some crops, that is his only means of production, suddenly has nothing. You actually destroy the agricultural thing. And you see this in some countries. You go to countries which are rice producing, who import all their rice due to civil war, etc. Right? And this is okay, the government. You know, there is no local production. Right? So what are people doing then? Nothing. Right? The majority of people are not able to have a certain means of production. And this is part of the destruction. Right? These are extreme examples of what happens. So genetically modified foods, the efficiency argument is we need to increase food production because that will help to feed people. But people are not just eating, right? It always looks at people as what? Consumers, right? Rather than producers of food. The majority of people in this world are involved in the production of food. And no policy looks at them as producers of food. Even in Europe, when we talk about slow food, etc., to a large extent is looked at as a consumption. What are we eating? What are we doing to our bodies? Instead of looking at it, right, from the production, because what is food that is produced goes, right? That's a cultural artifact, right? Or anything that is produced, that goes away. An artisanal product that is produced can be destroyed. Because it can be remade, right? All products are in fact open to that. But it is in fact the means of production, right? So if you have somebody who's weaving in a traditional manner, right? And there's an entire industry of weavers, and suddenly, what comes? Mills, cheaper cloth. Is it cheaper? Yeah. Is it better? Well, it has less defects. Anything man-made will always have more defects. Right?
I have a political argument anyway. I have tried to validate myself.
We do not exclude political arguments.
Okay.
So it's all right.
The WTO does not manage the global economy impartially, but in the operation has a systematic bias towards weak countries and multicultural corporations, and smaller countries which have less negotiation power. Such suggested examples and bias are, one, weak countries are able to maintain high import duties and quotas in certain products, blocking imports from developing countries, such like clothing. Two, the increase in non-tariff barriers such as anti-dumping measures allowed against developing countries. Three, the maintenance of high protection of agriculture in developed countries while developing ones are oppressed to open their markets. Four, many developing countries do not have the capacity to follow the negotiation and participate actively in the railway round. And fifth, which I regard very important, is the TRIPS agreement, which limits developing countries from utilizing some technology that originates from abroad in their local systems, including medicine and agricultural products. What is your take on this?
You want a general comment or is it a particular question?
Yeah, like, what is this injustice? You know, in our way to say the WTO is the economic balance, you know, is the motivator of our global economic system. And I found this personally to be very biased on how they operate the economy.
Yeah, but I think, I mean, this is, the answer has been present in the last hour, right? Okay. Right? When you make an efficiency argument, when you say trade is good, right, what are you doing? You're moving away from sovereignty. Sovereignty now is a bad idea, right? And perhaps for good reason in a particular way, but sovereignty represented what in a particular historical context? It represented decolonization, right? And it represented people who were colonized as taking control of the economic resources. I mean, if you remember, you don't have to remember, or I don't have to remember, but if you read it, right, what did Gandhi boycott first? Lancashire cloth, right? Mm-hmm. Why? Was he against Lancashire? No. But he realized that there was an economic mechanism which was in fact resulting in a transfer of wealth for a long time, where you were basically under unequal treatment because of colonization, forced to import finished goods and send out raw materials. Right? Which is why the Fabian School of Economics, which was a school from London, came out with self-sufficiency in art, which is why many countries post-colonization, post-World War II, adopted self-sufficiency. I mean, the idea that there is a complete unanimity that trade is good for development is not only contested, it's very new. Because for years, the very opposite was true. The idea was, we don't want imports, we don't even want to export. Okay, maybe that was a bad idea. But certainly, right, many countries adopted self-sufficiency because of the inequality of global trade that they were subjected to during colonization. So they adopted a means that you must be able, right? Which is why when I grew up, you had Indian versions of colas and two kinds of cars which had 60s technologies and that's the only ones you could buy. And nobody really thought that you should actually be a consumer. In fact, a minister in the government got up and very proudly said that we only have so many phones in the country, and in fact, that's all we really need because other people don't really need to communicate. They're not essential to the world. And this may have been wrong, but there was an ideological thing of self-sufficiency, of consumption not being the essence of development. Right? Even if we take consumption today as the essence of development, we won't talk about that, that's good. Without, in fact, addressing the means of production, this becomes a source of deep inequities, deep injustices, deep inequalities, right? Which in fact is traumatic for societies, for large sections of societies which are, you know, on the periphery, but not just in the periphery, even at the center. And the WTO, in fact, as a global economic governance system, is set up to do what? To take care of those inequalities. No, in fact, it explicitly excludes countries from acting in their democratic capacity to take care of those inequalities. Right? I mean, today, you know, I met somebody from Greece the other day. Greece is what? It's in the European Union, right? Developed country? I think that's now arguable. Whether it's still a developed country. Because you know, if you go to a public hospital in Greece, what do you have to take with you now? Your own medicines. This is a lawyer then. You have to take your own medicine because they don't have the means, the funding to buy medicine. This is what used to happen in the hospital, public hospitals in India, right? They said, you know, we haven't gotten the budget for medicine, we have the doctors, we have the operating theatre, here's what you need to buy, please go down and buy, I don't have the budget for it. This is Greece. It's a member of the European Union. Why can't Greece, because it has the money, it's never a problem of money, it's always a problem of distribution choices. Why can't Greece say, I'm sorry, I know I need you money, we do this every day, but I gotta buy medicines for this. Because it's limited by a different set of economic governance mechanism, rule of law mechanism, which restricts its rights. Which restricts its right to act democratically for its own citizens. Similarly, the WTO restricts your choices. You cannot go and say, I have a crisis. Right? You can have countervailing measures, but they can only be temporary. It has to be strictly with the principle of necessity. Necessity, which has been interpreted very narrowly. So of course, yes, it is going to be biased, and then the remedy, of course, comes back to being based on a real political system which configures itself based on your economic power. Does that answer your question in a long-winded way? Yeah. So, I mean, Chimney, which is a professor of law in India and talks about the third world approaches to international law, calls this the privatization of public sector, right? It's privatization of public sector, not like as public corporations, but the public sector. What would be public sector choices? Would be public choices which would be if you were a country with a level of legitimacy involving the stakeholders, what would be public sector choices are now limited. Like just like the Greek government is limited, or the government in Gambia is limited, right? Because it's not just WTO, but you know, one of the, and it's incredible for me, one of the, I warned her from WTO, but one of the principles, one of the conditions for getting IMF funding, which many countries needed because of balance payment problems, because of free trade, by the way, was what? A decrease in public investment. In what? Health. Not just agriculture. You had to decrease your investment in agriculture, which employed the maximum number of people, because why do you need agriculture? You can import your food. You don't need to support agriculture. You're an inefficient production of food. You are too inefficient to actually exist in your means of production. This is not an argument that's being used globally, it's used domestically, right? We have a new land acquisition law, which people argue, well, you know, we have too many people in agriculture, we need to make them into manufacturing workers. Irrespective of whether they consent to having their land acquired or not, that is efficient for development. So we must do so. You cannot keep, and some people may not, so consent is important, but you cannot keep doing what you want to do. You cannot carry on being in agriculture because you are inefficient. Of course agriculture is inefficient. You made it inefficient. You made it into something which cannot be, in fact, sustainable. And now it must go away and must be replaced with what? Automated, large factory farms. Right? People cannot be farmers anymore. And I make this not as a hyperbolic statement, but farmers are in fact anachronistic. In the modern economy, farming is an anachronistic profession. I come from a farming town. I've got one friend left as a farmer. Right? He likes his cows. He really loves his cows. He treats them very well. He puts eggs. I swear he treats his cows better than his workers. But you know, he's left doing this, you know, because he loves it. But it's not a sustainable profession. And you know, that's what he does. He rents out other people's farms who go get other jobs in the cities, and the farming income is a secondary. And we are, by the way, the most efficient farm, you know.
I think that is a recent political argument used in India. But if you look at the present publication on the economics, we have seen that more than $700 billion are used by developing countries on export revenues. This is not profitable, and this will not lead to sustainable development, which has been one of the primary pillars of the WTO. So if we think that our rules are leading to failure, why not change them now?
Well, why can't you change them? Because your ability to change them has been taken away from you. Who's going to change them? Who's going to change the rules? You sign on to WTO. Can you change the rules of WTO? Well, people are trying. The agreement is already signed. It's a multilateral treaty. Do you have the power as a small country to withdraw from WTO? Potentially, but likely not. It will be very difficult for your economy to sustain, because you will then be an outlier. Right? And I'm taking WTO as one example of other global economic. You have the ability to withdraw from IMF, from etc. There are means, for example, to set up alternatives, but then they just end up having their own issues, like the BRICS banking set up in Shanghai, right? Which is supposed to be a bank, which is a alternative to World Bank and right? But there's no, and there are alternatives to some extent set up, but even those alternatives have the same ideological underpinnings. They're just different countries fighting with other countries, but ideologically they're the same. Right? Because the issue is that global capital must have global rights, public rights, available not only in bilateral investment treaties, but World Trade Organization, which are free from what? Sovereign constraints. Right? And with that privilege, right, you say, okay, we are supporting investment in bilateral investment treaties, we are supporting trade, And if you have any argument which is impeding global trade, it must have a very high threshold of necessity, right? So consumer anxiety, like in the hormones case, is not enough because you don't have any proof. I mean, until you fight somebody with a third arm, you cannot stop it. I'm being facetious, but to an extent, it is that absurd, right? Because trade can't be impeded. And then, of course, I'm paraphrasing what is a very long argument. Right? Because they don't dismiss that the Europeans have the right under SPS to have measures to control what goes in and what animals are fed. But they say that this measure is not necessary, which is an incredible argument, meaning that every country's determination of what is their farmers going to put feed their cows, or what their consumers are going to consume, or what is sanitary, is subject to a review by a dispute settlement mechanism whose purpose is trade, where they not only review whether you are technically correct, which was the idea behind it, well, I follow the procedures, right, I made the determination, I defer to the executive that this determination was in fact correct, because I'm only looking at whether they made a determination based on the right choices. No, they go deeper. And they actually substantially review the determination by a country and say, almost like a constitutional court, to say whether that was consistent with the principles of free trade in the WTO. Other questions? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Because it is not clear to me how far this policy has gone. For instance, if only created in laboratory seeds are patented, or potentially every seed can be patented.
Under TRIPS.
Yes. If you know how is the current status of...
Well, every seed can be patented, right?
But
TRIPS implementation is still weaker than GATT implementation, right? Countries are implementing TRIPS in various ways, right? But in fact, this is a huge issue because, you know, not only can you patent a seed, but then you can go after people who never bought your seed, right? Because there's, what happens with seeds? They diffuse geographically, they travel.
So if it was just a now, for instance, very commonly I go to a garden or some people give me some seeds, which is the probability that they are really patented and which is the risk that I'm running, and am I sanctionable for this?
Yeah, so of course your sanctions will depend on domestic law, right? But the domestic law, which says, okay, this is ridiculous, we are not going to, in fact, you know, allow for people to be prosecuted for, you know, seeds that they never actually purchased, may be subject to the TRIPS and the WTO dispute resolution mechanism. Because there's also the World Intellectual Property, right? So you could say this country's laws are not sufficiently protective of intellectual property because they're not allowed. I mean, this is not just in seeds, but also in farm, right? Where there's a lot of disputes around fair use of patents, etc. You know, even if you have domestic courts making those decisions, they're being subjected to international or transnational review by, you know, courts sitting in Geneva saying, well, I know you made that determination, but because it impedes a property right or it impedes a trade right, that review was not, that decision was not correct, even though it's based on your rules. So the sanction would depend on domestic law, but if the domestic law didn't sanction you, theoretically, that domestic law would be challenged.
Then I assume that, of course, these kind of disputes will arise when interests are in a place of problem,
yeah.
When there is actually a form of trade.
I mean, but also there's a very large corporation. Monsanto is one of the most powerful corporations in the world, really, right? And it's based entirely on genetically genetically modified. The question you were asking when you were between genetically modified foods and seeds and hybrid seeds, right, which are two different kinds of seeds. Hybrid seeds are, of course, where two seeds are mixed, there's no genetic modification, but that's still patentable, right? I mean, in fact, you can patent ridiculous things, right? There are companies in the world who just exist from exploitation of patents.
So, an overall assessment could be that actually nowadays, majority of the patented seeds are GMOs and these hybrid seeds.
Yeah, hybrid seeds have always been there, right? But GMOs, of course, are increasingly there. Because the thing with GMOs is you can do that hybrid seeds can't. Because, for example, in genetically modified food, you can take away the ability to reproduce. Seeds, of course, give other seeds, but you can take away that ability.
Even if they are sterilized.
Right. So, what have you just done? I mean, one of the things that commercialization of seeds. Seeds was never a commercial input in farming. Now it's become a huge input in farming, right? And it's an investment which leads you into financial income. So seeds was never, in fact, an economic input. Because what did you do for seeds?
You just keep
You kept the last ones, maybe you bought a few new ones, but there was never a cost to it. It was very minimal input into farming. You've increased that input cost incredibly.
But today, for instance, a very specific locus in particular of a certain region, is it likely to have been patented already or not?
But there's so many things that have been patented because you need to change it a little bit, and then there are countries which are patenting their own products to try and protect them as a protective patent because they don't want an international corporation, because of course one of the rules of patentability is that you must get it first. So there's a whole series of, you know, where you have to challenge patents by companies, where they'll do a slight hybrid and say this is not patent, because their company will just exist in exploiting these legal rules, right? Like the vulture capitalists we talked about in the context of bilateral investment treaties.
Okay, thanks. Mm-hmm. What are the consequences for country of quitting the WTO?
Quitting? Well, you're an outlier, you can quit. But then, you know, if you have exports,
you're not allowed to trade with countries.
No, you're allowed to trade, but they don't have to give you equal treatment. So if you have any exports, they could be subject to a higher tariff than other countries, right?
And so price will be higher.
Price will be higher for your exports. You will have discrimination. You will not get most favored nation. So there's going to be a sufficient number of producers in your own country which are going to be opposed to you quitting, right? Who rely on most favored nation treatment, right? So in currently, China didn't join initially. And in fact, there was a lot of debate about China joining the WTO, right? And it was, even though it was a major participant in the global trade, it was not a party to the original negotiations. And over 15 years, it negotiated and certainly had to give a lot of concessions to join the WTO, same in Russia.
And Russia was negotiating for 18 years, I guess. Exactly. Yeah.
And then it joined, because it's increasingly difficult to be an outlier, because the system perpetuates itself. Once the system is big enough, then the outlier is a cost. Okay, so we take a break.